most of all, I hope you like the training, because of course I like hard training, but I also like to share stories, and you can laugh sometimes, and so I hope you will like it. I'm sure you will like it. Okay. Can we start?
Yes.
Good idea. Okay. Yeah, face me. Or you want to start? You want to start here? And move in and out. So this is the basic position. Every time you go back to this position. Then lift your knees. Go. Change. Okay, let's move. We do the same with a middle kick. Round kick. How do you say this?
Round kick.
Round kick.
Okay.
Round kick. In America, they say round house. Just round kick. Roundhouse, round kick, whatever. You start on the left. Yes. Catch. So next, we're going to make a combination of front kick, middle kick. So front, middle. There you go, left, front, middle. Change. Okay. Keep on moving. back you, you make 1, 2. 1, 2. Ready? Make combination between the arms and the legs. You start with 1, 2, middle. So, left, right, left, middle. When you start for, of course, right, left, right, middle. Okay? Here we go. Thank you. I can't relax. Who's sweating more than me? More than me?
I think so, yeah. Well, maybe.
Maybe not.
Maybe not.
Your feet together. Yes. Yes, close the front. You should pull, you should feel it in your lower back, right? Very flexible if you feel something at all. Okay, thanks. Okay, sit on your knees, put your hands behind you, and then go to the back as far as possible. Slowly, slowly, as far as possible. Corner, and after you We will start our first combination with, I like to start with the favorites. So we start with left, right, left hook, right low kick. Yeah, very basic, but very effective. So we make one, two, three, four. And then the low kick, you will defend. Yeah, because when you train, when you spar, when you fight, you have to defend. So in the training, I never do this like taking the kick. I better get used to make this move. Yeah, so you make one, two, three, four. Now you go. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Yeah. Like this, yes? Back and forth. Thank you. Go ahead. Now you must defend.
You both
need the defense.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You don't have to count it. You don't have to see is that when you kick the low kick,
okay,
then you
kick a little bit lower,
yeah, okay, then you block like this, yeah,
kick a little bit more low,
yes. So if somebody kicks very hard, then don't do it now, please. But you can, then you will be able to hit this leg, and then you will be sweating, yeah. So what I like to do. And maybe the trainers will not like it because you might hurt each other. What I like to do is I like to defend like this. Boom, here. I don't do this, but I do this. You like it?
No.
No. That's what I want. Yeah? So what I do is I defend with this part, the hardest part of my shin, basically, yeah, basically. Of course, when you train, you have to be careful with each other, because defending like that is, it hurts. And if you kick too hard, then you will not like it. But I think when you defend and you lift your leg high, and you can be swept away, yeah? I'm a fighter, sorry. That's how I think. So try. We're gonna do only the right low kick and then try to defend. Can you see it over there? Can you all see it? Okay. Try to defend like this. Here. Well, if somebody gets hurt, it's the one who kicks. Okay? So three times. Kick three times and try to defend like that. Yeah? Go.
Thank you.
Short defense. And then we make a straight, the right straight. Yep, okay. Okay.
Yes, nice.
believe me, you're going to pay for it. So some of you with the knees, some of you grab like this. But when you grab somebody here, you don't have control. I like control. And you can control like this. Yes, that's basically okay. But like after the move I made, like one, two, then I like to control here. I like to control here. He cannot do so much. He can try to kick me. Oh, sorry. He can try to punch me. But the moment he punched me, yeah, basically. So that's why what I like about this move, when you do it fast. So when we were fighting, I do it fast. Boom, boom. Then I have the full control. I have full control. If you do this, there's no control at all. What he's gonna do? Yeah, he's gonna drop me. I don't like that. So think about it. I'll come back to it later. We're gonna do some more moves with the knees. Okay. The next. We did it in the warming up. We're gonna make a front kick. So when I make a front kick, what will you do? Yeah, exactly. When I make a front kick, exactly, that's what you want to do. But now I'm going to fool you. Yeah, we're going to do this. Nice, huh?
Football thing?
Huh?
We messed up.
Yeah.
It's too fast.
Too bad. So that's the basic idea of this move. So you can put your hands on your leg, on your body, on your stomach if you want. And I make one and put up. One, two. Up, again. So one, one, two. Before I put my leg down, I make the left punch. Yeah. So this one, one. Yeah. Basically, it's like that. Yeah. So don't wait to put your leg down and punch, then you're too late. Basically. Yeah. So you make one, two, three. And then we follow with the high kick on that side. And that's why I didn't pick a big guy. I'm smart sometimes. Yeah, so you make one, two, three, and then four. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
happens when he kicks?
Your leg moves.
Huh?
Your leg moves.
My leg moves, yeah, but I do that because he otherwise if you do it three more times, I cannot walk on. What happened with him? Do it again. Now it's changing. Change, eh? What did you change?
I wasn't stepping in, I was just kicking.
No. Left hand? Again. Exactly. The left hand. Because when you kick, when you make a round kick, you always drop the side. The side you kick with. Yeah? Yes or no?
Yes.
So, that's what you do. Drop your hand, please. Otherwise I'm alive. So I was in a fight once. Way back. I was in a fight once and I did the same. Yeah? Give me the boom. And my opponent did this. And I did this. I was dancing. I wasn't knocked out. Unfortunately, later the fight I was knocked out. But yeah, I looked the fight back and I saw that move. I saw that move. I thought, oh, that's a good one. I'm gonna use it. I never trained it with my trainers. I put it in my system myself. And with this move I made, I think, around 5 or 6 knockouts. So it was very successful for a move I never trained, really trained with my trainers. I trained it only myself. So what you're gonna do is when you're gonna kick me, put your right hand here, open, yeah? So the moment you kick, I'm gonna punch you, yeah? So you're gonna boom. You kick, I punch. You kick, the moment I see the kick coming, boom, I punch. Okay? So let's do it. Let's change every 3 times. Yeah? I want to hear these persons are fighting.
Sorry?
Who's fighting?
Fighting 1, 2, 3,
so
4,
body.
Maybe all of them.
Seven.
So in the future, I want to hear you say, yeah, and then so we did this technique and we made a knockout.
Yeah?
Okay. Next. I have an alternative for this one, which I like a lot too. I wasn't successful in the fight with it, but I like it. We do the inside kick. This time we switch. Okay? This time we switch. Okay? After the switch, we make a left high kick. One, two. Ooh, take it with two hands, please. Yes. One, two. Yeah. So, switch. Thank you. Okay. There we go. Other low kick, the right low kick. Okay?
Okay. Yes. I covered it. Last Sunday, I was in the fight at home. And I was together with Peter Arts. We went to the picture together. And then I was brave, and then people said, oh, he's old. Okay, we attack with front kick. Left or right. Yeah? Front kick, left or right. Yeah. The defense is only with the front hand. Can you attack with your left? Like this. I asked the last group too, so the people who were there cannot answer. Why do I only defend with my front hand? What?
So you can
No.
First point of contact?
Yes. Yes. This is part of the reason. Part of the reason. I show you. I do with you. I attack you.
Yeah.
Okay. So when I kick with the right, what would you do? No. What would you do?
I would probably
do that. You would do this. You would do that. Okay. I show that as the form of the two. For example, if you make the right front kick and you defend like that, and I'm a little bit panicking, this is what I'm gonna do.
This is what I will do.
I will panic and then I will knock you out because I'm panicking.
Yeah.
Well, if you defend with your front leg, I will have no chance to do that. Again, I will try to hit you.
Wish more, please, because otherwise I am not right. Otherwise I'm lying.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I will not be able to hit you. Even if I will be able to hit you, I cannot hit you right. Well, if you do it with your other hand, you go right to it. But that's dangerous, in my opinion. And I'm like safety first guy, so only defend with your front hand. Yeah. So after we've done that, this hand will be on the leg. You make the left foot. Yeah, you can put your hand here. So either left or right, attack, boom, boom. Yeah, boom. One move. Yeah? People will tend to stop to make this. One, two. Don't. Just make one move. One, two. Right away. Yeah? One, two. Like that.
Thank you.
Did you hit me? I just knocked you out. Okay. So you will attack me with the right. What I will do is I defend, and at the same time I cross with my left leg. Yes. So this is what I will do. Yeah. This is what I do. Yeah. I defend. Boom. I did it many times in the fight. By the way. Yeah. Boom. So the same as the attack with the middle kick, counter low kick. The weight now is on this leg, so he cannot lift. He cannot defend. So it's easy for me. I'm the one person he won't hurt. If you hurt me, that's it. Boom, here. Now the weight is on this leg, so he cannot block. Then I hit. Yes? So, one, two, like this. One.
Thank you.
When I get attacked with a left hook, when I'm sharp and everything, then I will defend by coming forward. Put my hand out, that, coming forward. That's what I will do. Yeah? Boom. If I'm not sharp, I will step out. But I like this move. Boom. Then we make with the other hand, you make it straight. Yeah? So, defend and then make it straight. Defend straight. Defend straight. Defend straight, and if you want, you can finish with a low kick. Yeah? So, one, two, three, the low kick you can defend. You can block. Yeah? So, one, two, three. Okay? One, two, three. I like it. I don't like it, that's why I like it. Yeah? I don't like it, that's why I like it. Yeah? You like it, eh? It hurts. Shit. Sorry? I don't do it anymore. But, I don't like it anymore.
I like this.
Yeah, like that.
Yeah. Everybody saw it?
Yeah.
I don't have to do it again?
Yeah.
Okay. I used to.
We will attack with middle kick, left or right. And you will make a lock on the other leg. Yeah? Inside or outside? Still try to do it.
5 minutes.
Okay, so 25.
5 minutes. On my left. On my left move. This one I like a lot. This one I train a lot. It's very good for your condition. Very good for your condition. One side, go attack. All the punches, all the kicks, not too hard. Yeah. Try to do it fast. The other side can only defend. When as I switch, then the attacker becomes the defender and the defender becomes the attacker. Yeah. So every time as I switch, you switch. But you never know when as I switch. So sometimes the switch takes long, but other times the switch takes very short. Yeah. Do this before? Yeah. So you get it. You guys understand?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Then I'm going to stand here. So this side we start with attack and we start with the defense. Defense. Yep. Yeah. Now basically it's boxing on the head, but everything. But you can, of course you cannot let's say not more than 50%.
No, I'm not ready.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe you guys don't have guns or something, so be careful. Yeah. Just go for the speed. Okay? Okay. Ready?
Wait.
All start together. Ready? Okay, go. Thank you.
Stretch your left leg. Place your right shoulder to the front. And bring your nose to your left. Close your left. Change. Stand on your left heel like this. Grab your toes. Move towards you. Bring your nose towards your left. Inside low kick. You can be inside low kick. Ow. Yeah, you were kicking so hard. Get up. Again.
Because most of the people, when they kick, me myself, I did it too one time. I did this. So please do that. Not this. Because most of the people drop and they make a middle or a round, move. They drop their hands from the side where they kick it. So I got into that once, I did it once, and then I got hit like that, and then I was drunk, but I wasn't KO'd, yes, I was KO'd 4 hours later, for my bad luck, but I used it, I saw it back on the video, and I used the move, and I made six knockouts with it, so it was very successful. So you get me you drop the hand and you keep this hand here. Yeah? So the moment the punch comes, you hit. It right. This is low stop. Yes, because otherwise I'm gonna shout very hard. Because then I'm in pain.
Be careful with it.
How many times did I hit it on his right leg?
5 or 6.
Huh?
5 or 6.
How many times did he hit it?
Okay, so one.
The first time. When I was standing south, when I was standing on the foot. Yeah? Everybody saw it?
Yeah.
So, even though he knew that I was kicking on his left leg, still it was difficult for him to defend. Yes or no?
Yeah.
Did you feel that hit you a few times?
Yeah.
Okay. So it was, of course, I didn't concentrate on the rest, and you were too fast for me, blah, blah, blah. I'm too old. Everything, I know that. But you saw that I hit you 5 or 6 times with your leg. That's the advantage of a southpaw fighter. I trained myself to fight southpaw. Of course, orthodox is more, I like it more. But southpaw also works. Southpaw also works. You know? Especially when I stand southpaw and I kick you on your leg. Because I want to say that at least 4 out of 5 times I'll hit you. Because you're not used to defend. You used to defend the left. You're not used to defend the right. So what are you going to do? One side is going to stand both legs. One side is going to stand southpaw. Then you're going to try to spar. No more sparring, but concentrate on the back side, back leg locking.
Up!
We're not finished yet, but take off the gloves. Shin pads, you can also take off if you want.
I'll start. What would you say was your toughest fight?
Yeah, I get that question many times. And every time I'm like, what was my toughest fight? I never know. I fought a very tough fight with Rick Rufus. In 92, 12 rounds in contact. It was physically the toughest. I think one of my toughest fights was with Andy Hook. I lost that fight in 96, 20 years ago. It was in the tournament. He won the tournament. It was draw after three rounds, and then the fourth round was very tough. He rocked me one time. They gave it a draw again, and then I thought, oh, the last round, now I have to give it all. And I'm sure I won that round, but okay, doesn't matter. And then I lost. And the fact that I gave it all and still I lost, I think that was the toughest fight.
Who would you say is the best stand-up, fighter on the planet just now?
Right now?
Yeah.
Difficult. Maybe in the I think Guacao is still very good. Heavyweight, it's Rico van Hoof. Maybe Rico. So I think Rico. Because I saw him train and in his last fights he was really sharp, and I think he trained with an English guy. What's the world champion now? The boxing?
Tyson Fury.
He trained with Tyson Fury. And I think it really helped him to become a better fighter. Yeah.
So, used to know you guys, great guys that fought. What did the judges think when Kaelin started to bring in Charlie, and sumo wrestlers and Bob Sapp? These guys not
the problem. The problem was that K1 had financial problems.
Yeah.
But they needed something new. And we were all good fighters. Yeah. But apparently not attractive enough anymore or something. So they invented something new. They invented Bob Sapp. And Akebono. Yeah, I think in the beginning it worked, especially because they made sure I lost.
But
that helped
back
them a lot. Sorry?
But you came back and until you won it?
Yeah, I came back and everything, but still Bob Sapp made his name. And Bob Sapp became very popular and very famous and made a lot of money
with all the
commercials he did. Mm-hmm. Not with the fights. With the fights he didn't make anything, but with the commercials he made a lot of sports.
You think that spoils the sport a bit?
But then they made a mistake they went on. They were too much with the big guys, and that ruined it.
Yeah.
At the end, it ruined.
At the start, it was interesting, and then I thought.
At the start, it was interesting. Exactly. And K1 had a big financial problems. They had a big tax problem because the big boss that he didn't pay the tax. We had from 96, we had to pay some kind of entertainment tax or something, 20%. And they just said it like Sunday is the fight. Saturday they told us, yeah, we're gonna deduct the 20% extra. I think I'm a natural talent, and what I could do within a month, some others couldn't do in a year. And they tried their best, but they couldn't do it. So I think it's a real natural. What is the?
What's the biggest event?
The biggest event? As far as spectators?
Yeah.
How many people? Okay.
You mean the biggest event you fought?
The hardest I fought?
No, the biggest event that you fought.
Biggest event. The biggest event was they called it Shockwave. I saw it on YouTube actually. Somebody posted it on YouTube. I fought with Sammy Schilt, and then there were 92,000 people.
What?
Yeah, I had to fight. I had to fight 11 days before. I fought in Las Vegas, and what I really wanted to do because it was. I think the stadium where they did the final, the World Cup final for football in 2002. And I really want to experience 100,000 people. So there were 92,000. And it was a bad fight against Sammy Schilt before the draw, but I think he won. But it was a great experience to fight for so many people.
Was there anybody that you didn't get the opportunity to fight against that you wish that you had?
When I think about it now, I would have liked to fight with a guy like Francois Botha or something. Because he was a world champion in boxing. And at some point, Mike Tyson said he was interested in fighting me. So I would have been a little bit scary maybe thinking about it, knowing his power in boxing. But it would have been a big honor to fight with Tyson. Yeah.
Who would you like to fight
now?
Today, your week card, is there anyone getting fighter?
I'm not good enough anymore.
But change the time machine.
I'm thinking about what kickboxer I missed.
Hopefully,
Bada Hari? Yeah, Bada maybe. Maybe Bada. Bada? He was supposed to fight once in Holland, but the fight was supposed to be in June or the end of May, and they wanted to announce it already in October, early October, and that was too long for me. I didn't want to be confronted with that for almost 9 months, so I said no, I don't want to do that. If it was 2 or 3 months, it would be okay, but the 9 months. And I understand the promoter, because the promoter, he needed to sell his tickets. But for me, it was too long. That's why I didn't. But said that he really would like to. He was, but I was never but I didn't like training so much. And maybe sometimes you could see it in his fights too, because he was tired very. But he was like, yeah, I really would try to. I really would like to fight with him. So then why I was like, okay, it's okay. I want to do it. But then when they said, when they wanted to announce it already in October, and then being confronted with that, that was in 2009, I think. 2010, the fight would be. So then I would be 44. And I was like, no, this takes too long. I have too much pressure. Everybody who will say I'm too old and everything, I wouldn't like that, so that's why.
I was training with the Tyrone Spall. You were training him for a while?
Yeah, I mean Tyrone is a big talent. Yeah, he's already past 30, so I can't say he's a talent anymore, but yeah, it was interesting to train with him. But then he also made, in the training, in my opinion, he made mistakes. He liked to do the moves, especially the moves to the legs. It was too predictable, in my opinion. His hands are very good when he starts boxing, but it's either the hands or the legs. No combinations, and I tried to teach him more combinations, but I failed. He didn't want to do it. And when I see the way he broke his leg against Saki, it was all like single kicks, everything single, and guy like Saki, who is very sharp on those kind of things, it was very easy for him to defend.
That's why he broke his leg.
That's why I broke his leg. Yeah. So I'm not gonna say I told you so, but I was focusing on that. I was focusing on that. I told him every time, make combinations. Don't just throw the kick, because it's too dangerous. Yeah.
Anyone else got any? What's up at Boss?
Sorry?
Is there jail at Boss at all? Teach up at Boss?
Me?
Yeah.
No. I stopped at Voss after when I retired in 2006. Then I stopped teaching at Voss also. And right now I'm teaching and training a little bit in the gym I started. I live in a small town called Hoorn. Hoorn is around half an hour from Amsterdam. I started training there when I was 15, and now I'm training there again. So after I left, I trained for myself for a while. I had my own team, and with Spawn, and with some other fighters. And now I'm training there again.
Would you ever have one last fight?
Sorry?
Would you ever think about having one last fight, maybe coming back out of retirement? Or?
Yeah, for a lot of money. Yeah, basically, I mean, I know I'm not the top of the world anymore in fighting. I know that I'm too old for that. If somebody would like me to fight, yeah, then if you want to pay a lot of money, I would do it. Otherwise, I would. Because it's all, when you get older, you realize the risk you take. When you fight when you're young, you don't realize that so much. But as older as you get, you realize it more and more. So I wouldn't take that risk anymore.
How long were you training for your first fight?
Sorry?
How long were you training?
For my very first fight, I was 15 when I started training. I was 18 when I fought my first fight. I trained for a little bit more than 2.5 years. I think that was very much in my benefit. I took the time to, my trainer was just started to teach. So he wanted to be sure that his fighter was good enough, blah, blah, blah. So it took me a long time to do the first fight. And did somebody happen to see my first fight? It's on YouTube. It was in 83. And it was, I had a good opponent. It was a Kyokushin fighter. And he hurt my leg a lot. Actually, the move we made with the inside kick and the right, actually, I made that move my first fight. I knocked him out like that. But he hurt my legs a lot because he didn't kick. Actually, I forgot something. Shit. He didn't kick. He kicked me on my right leg. He kicked me on my right leg. And you're not used to defend with your right leg when you're standing orthodox. You're used to defend with your left leg.
You can do it in the next step.
Yeah, we'll do. Because when you I experienced it when I fought with Andy Hook. The second time when I lost, then he started kicking me on my right leg because he was a southpaw, and I couldn't defend in the beginning. So after a few kicks, I realized, oh shit, I have to defend. But you're not used to lift your right leg. You're used to lift your left leg, but you're not used to lift your right leg. So that was something I have learned. And I actually, my last fight, when I fought with Peter Arts a year and a half ago, I thought I'm gonna try it one time. So I kicked him left on his right leg, and he couldn't block. Why did we come to this question? So he kicked me all the time on the right leg, and at some point I saw his defense gone, and I gave him the right, and then he was out, and I thought that I fought the best fight of my life. It was the best fight, of course it was the first, but the rest, the knockout was very good, but the rest didn't look so good. And I will always say the difference between my first and my second fight is way bigger than the difference between my second and my last fight. Because after the first fight, I knew what it was, and that would make all the difference, in my opinion.
And what about kind of long-term effects? Obviously, you've been fighting for a long time at a high level. What about kind of long-term effects on your body?
When I was 39, just before the K1 Grand Prix 2004, I got a problem with my right arm. I was doing some weight lifting, and then suddenly it wouldn't move anymore. That was big. I put a cortisone steroid in it. I thought K1 first, like, okay, there's something coming into my body. Is it okay or not? Otherwise, I will not fight. They said okay. I have so many things. I had things on my legs. I was knocked out a few times. Of course, that is not healthy. That's not good for your. Yeah, you don't see it, but you know it. You forget things sometimes, and maybe not because of the knockout, but because of everything all those years. But I'm very happy I can still speak normally. Because it's not everybody can say that.
Do you think it's worth the risk overall? You know, like your health and stuff, you're saying the concussions and things, I think overall it's worth it.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. some I hear some fighters talk, and then I think, ooh, I hope I don't sound like that.
What's the worst injury you ever had?
I think the knockout against Francisco Filho. I got knocked out, and I don't know how I got into the dressing room. Mm-hmm. Yeah, later I saw myself walking, but I cannot remember it. But that was very scary. I think that's the worst, I think.
Can you take us through a normal training day, what you used to do day to day in training, like a normal training session leading up to a fight?
I would, you know, you develop yourself throughout the years, and the way I prepared myself when I was 25 was different from the way I prepared myself when I was 40. But what I would basically do is, in the morning I could do like weight training or something, or running. So the one day running, the other day weight training, and sometimes I would take a rest, and then in the afternoon technical training and sparring for about 1 hour, and that I would do 3 to 4 times a week. That's it, basically. And then sometimes I would do pet training. What I like to do is, and I still do it sometimes with the guys I train now. Like the pet kicking with partner, and then like 3 minutes. And then the first minute, one time, left, right. The second minute 2 times, the third minute 3 times, and then 5 rounds. And then the second round I would do 2, 3, 4, or maybe one more time, 1, 2, 3, and then 2, 3, 4, and 3, 4, 5, 4, 5, 6, 5, 6, 7. So doing it with a partner was okay, because if you had to do it by yourself, then you had less rest. I prefer to do it with a partner.
What's your motivation? Obviously, fighting is quite an extreme sport. So, what was your motivation and your driving force behind your training and your career?
When K1 was there, definitely become champion again and again. I mean, started in '93. I came into the final. I had two very tough fights with Peter Arts and Maurice Smith. Many injuries coming into the final against Branko Sikatic, who had two easy fights. And yeah, I was not concentrated. I had a second semi-final. And I remember going back to the dressing room, taking my gloves off, and putting ice on my hand, because my right hand was damaged, my right leg was damaged. So I put ice on my hand and on my leg, and then 2 minutes later they came again to take me to do the final. I had no time at all to recover. While he had more time. All the time that I was fighting was his rest. And later on they changed that, and they came with reserve fights or with extra fights to give the fighters more rest. But in the beginning, it was way different. So that was, that was different.
Is there a lot of changes between, you know, the sort of 90s to now, how the fights work and how K1 works?
Yeah, well, yes, because apart from that, now they have reserve matches. It's also because of me. Because of me, they just started the reserve matches. They had the rule was in the beginning that if a winner would be injured, then the loser of that fight would continue. But when I lost to Bob Sapp, and Bob Sapp could not continue, and I continued and won the fight, won the tournament, then they changed it. Then they put a reserve fighter. Actually, I think that's a good rule. But I was lucky that that rule was not in effect yet when I became the champion the last time.
Anyone else got
questions?
Do you have a game
plan
for future opponent, or do you just go
when you're in? No. I'm a strange guy as a fighter, because I don't listen so much to trainers and coaches. Sometimes they say something I can use, but most of the time they talk some bullshit, in my opinion. So then I don't listen. So what I would do up front is, like in a single fight, I would check out my opponent. But if I would know him, I wouldn't check him out. Like if I would fight for the fifth time against Peter, or for the fifth time against Jerome or something, I wouldn't train especially for them. I wouldn't do that. But otherwise, I would. And what I would always do is, that was very important to me, I would visualize their strong points and their weak points. I would visualize my own strong points and weak points towards that opponent. And that helped me a lot. So walking to the ring, concentrating, I was only thinking like, what is he going to do with me? What does he want to do with me? What can I do back? What will he like? What will he not like? Those kind of things I would put in my head, and many times it worked for me, because the things he would do, I could see, and I could do something about it. Yeah, sometimes it didn't work, and then I would lose. But those things, I didn't do it from the beginning. I learned to do that during my career, and nobody taught me that. I taught myself.
Who's your favorite fighter to watch now?
I still like Buakaw when he fights. I like Rico Verhoeven. Else. Yeah, there are a few guys. There's a guy, I like Andy Sauer. There are a few guys I like to see sometimes who have some power. I was never a fighter who would go for the KO right away, but I do like those kind of fighters. Although I wasn't like that.
Why do you think Holland produces so many top level fighters?
I think from the beginning, when the sports came to Holland, Holland is a small country. They mobilized many karate guys to do kickboxing. So that was in the 70s. So kickboxing became mainstream on the gyms quite fast. And they created a system right away, actually, to not right away, but quite soon, from the new fighters, the C class, the B class, and the A class. In other countries, it was not that much developed. So the new fighters, they would have to win two fights, I think. Then they would become C class. They would have to win three or four fights, and they would become B class. They had to win five fights, and then they were A class. And A class then is the highest. And I think that system worked quite good. Yeah.
What do you think about Dutch style versus traditional Thai style? Why do you think it varies so much? Is it because of the karate influence?
Maybe. But if you look at the Dutch style now, I think they keep on progressing. And there are still many events, many small events in Holland. I mean, every week, every weekend, there are at least three or four events. And I don't think it's like that in every country. And maybe even more events. So the fighters get, especially in the beginning, they get many a chance to show themselves and to fight. And of course from the B class, then they get paid, not that much, but still. And in the A class, somebody farting. Okay, whatever.
He's just destructing the whole thing then, isn't it?
And in the A class, it's more difficult. Right now there's a system. Before it was just like you'd get a certain amount of money, but now the fighters, since K1 started, yeah, the fighters like me, Peter, we were too expensive because we got much more money in Japan, so we wouldn't fight in Holland anymore. So then they started with the system of the VIP tables. So in the beginning, it was like you could buy a VIP table, but now it is like a fighter who is not that popular gets paid in a table and maybe a little bit cash, and so sell your own table.
Yeah, commission.
And sell your own table, and if you don't sell your table, yes, you have no money. And of course not everybody like fight like Badahari or something. He doesn't have to pay, he doesn't have to sell tables. I also never had to sell tables.
You got
yeah. Although that time, I mean I did one fight in 2001. I did one fight in 1994, I think. And then in 2001, and then 2006, and like 2001, 2006, I didn't have to pay to sell tables. No. And at the one hand, I understand the promoter because he doesn't want to take a risk. At the other hand, I don't like the system so much.
Yeah. Me too, I understand, because sometimes it's not good for the guys that want to go through the ranks because they can't sell tables. So the promoters don't put them on their show.
Yeah, is it the same here?
It's the same, same. Yeah. Sometimes the promoter will cancel one fighter and put another one on because he's not sold enough tickets. It's terrible.
That's too bad. But I understand because the promoter takes a risk. And
Do you not think that's holding the sports back though by doing that? You know,
I think it is, although it's very ticket driven, not even just in Thai, in boxing as well.
In boxing as well?
Boxing as well is ticket driven.
But the boxing there is also with the tables, the VIP tables.
Yeah, commission. You're paid in commission. You know, you sell tickets and stuff, but sometimes promoters have it if they're like, you only sold a few tickets. Last time they'll be like, oh, I don't want to put an extra fight in the card and no tickets. But it happens. It happens in Thai and as well.
Yeah, I understand that at one end. But it's. I had one time. I had a fighter, and he was paid in tables, two tables I think, and a little bit cash. And he didn't sell the tables, so there was no money. There was a little bit money, you know. I don't like that. I mean, the fighter gets an extra job, selling his table. You know, making his money before the fight. That's, I don't like it, but that's how the sport is now. Yeah, and everybody use that system now. In Holland, the Last Glory event, they didn't work with the tables. They only had VIP chairs and but no tables, and I liked it better. I mean, last Sunday I was at a nice event in Holland. Good fights, and I was invited. I was at a table with Peter Arts and his wife, it's nice for me to sit and eat something, but sometimes it happens that at the moment I'm eating something, then a knockout falls, then I miss it. You know, those kind of things. And, I mean, it distracts you too. Yeah.
Do you have any nutritional advice to
food and
nutrition?
Eating and
basically, what I do is like when I prepare for a fight, I always have to I had to lose weight. When I wasn't the heavyweight, I made sure that I would last week. I would only drink water, I would eat normally, and then maybe if I had to lose a little bit, I would use the sauna. And then later, when I was heavyweight, then I didn't need to do that anymore. But after my 35th, 36th, then it wasn't that easy to stay well trained, or without any fat. So that was more difficult then. And then later I learned to focus on the fight, and I like sweets too much, for example. You know, I've had it all my life, so I always had that. So as I say, since from 35 it was a problem.
Still is. No nutritional advice.
What I did is you know, it's like, for example, for my last fight against Peter, I trained very hard. I just focused on good food, no candies, no nothing, and then I was very good shape. That was very good shape. Yeah.
Anyone else? Last one,
do you think you can fight at any age? Like, if you've got the motivation and the skill to do it, do you think that a 35-year-old could fight for the first time? Maybe not, you know, an A class or anything like that, but get in the ring and do it.
I think that will be
very difficult. I think when you, for example, what I do now sometimes in Holland, I don't know if I do it in Scotland or in Great Britain too. Like the veteran fighters who never fought, but who like to train, who always like training, and they have 35 or 40, and then they do their first fight. They have quite big events in Holland with that. But for myself, I thought about doing it in Japan. I wanted to start K1 or the veterans, some kind of veterans event with old fighters, with Sam Greco, RSFO, Peter Arts. I tried to do that, and I because I thought if you do it like that, then the old heroes, they can still attract some people, but it was difficult. I talked with some TV stations about it, and then they say, yeah, interesting. At the end of the day, they don't do it. And for myself, for me, I know it's enough, you know. I know I cannot do anymore. I'm not good enough anymore. So I want to myself. Or if they pay me a lot of money, then I will reconsider.